Hi, everyone. It's probably not an exaggeration to say that many of us here today took a very traditional and recognisable route into archaeology. We went to university to get a degree, maybe staying on to do postgraduate qualifications or going straight into industry. We've progressed through the sector, sometimes by taking chances, career chances, other times by following career advancement opportunities because we were in a position to be able to do so. And to date, as a sector, that is generally how we have created the archaeologists we think we need. And those narrow entry routes have had a big impact on who we are. That's not breaking news. We've already heard this morning about those that data and those issues that persist in our sector. We're not a diverse profession, and I think two factors that really do contribute to that are the narrow entry routes into careers in archaeology and the equitable access to career development opportunity. By getting stuck in that almost self-perpetuating cycle of career development, it has an impact on how we recruit, how we retain, and how we're able to retain, especially during difficult economic times. So how can we address that? Well, it's never going to be one initiative that's going to solve it all, but we believe that with the work that we do at CIfA, that supporting professional development is an important element in addressing the inequalities that still exist in our sector. It also helps create competent archaeologists who are working towards professional standards and contributes towards sustainable careers. And that belief is reflected in our 10-year strategic plan, where we aim to support the continued development of a career of archaeology as a career for all. We want to shape and promote archaeology as an attractive, rewarding, and worthwhile career. And we aim to do that by creating and supporting new initiatives to enable our archaeologists of the now and the future to have access to viable career routes. How we create and develop our current and future talent has changed dramatically since I started my career. And CIfA has been involved in quite a lot of those changes. Career paths are defined in some areas of our profession. A new entrant or an early career colleague can start to plot and progress into a specific role. Tangible, visible, and mapped out career progression is acknowledged as a crucial factor in retaining the staff and the expertise we need to meet the requirements of our audiences and stakeholders. Formal training and qualifications have been developed to support a heritage professional to gain the specialist skills they need to complete their work. And the big one for me is the creation of different entry routes into the profession, one of which is apprenticeships. Apprenticeships are a really fantastic opportunity for an individual to learn on the job within a formal framework and to achieve a qualification at the end of it. They're important not only because they offer an individual a different entry route into a career in archaeology, but they can also allow the sector to address specialist skill gaps and support succession planning, a vital area that the sector, that as a sector, we've not been the best at formally addressing in the past. And certainly some of the work that I'm doing in Scotland, we've got some really crucial skill crises about on the horizon. We've got specialists starting to think about retirement and we're going to lose that skills and that specialist knowledge. But with apprenticeships, it has been a long road to get them up and running, but it's a road that CIfA has been on right from the start. Our work in Scotland, leading on the development of apprenticeships, is a fresh reminder of the challenges that we face as a sector to develop these initiatives. Those challenges include convincing non-heritage stakeholders to invest in the development of these initiatives. And that includes the challenges of convincing those stakeholders to release those vital funding opportunities to allow the development process to take place and to progress to those next stages. We lack the numbers of candidates that these stakeholders look for when assessing business cases. We get compared to the construction industry, which are able to take on over 100 apprenticeships a year. We can pledge usually 10 to 20, a number which is reliant on certain projects taking place in those geographical locations. But we do score really highly on other areas of assessment. So for example, we score highly on the social value of the work that we do. We score highly on retention rates. A lot of our apprenticeships that go through the system, or go through the process, they stay on and they complete their apprenticeship. And it's been reported that there's a big demand from our clients as well that they want archaeology apprenticeships on the projects that they're funding and taking forward. Fortunately, in Scotland, our time is funded by the Historic Environment Scotland, and all of our work supports the active delivery of Scotland's archaeology strategy, the skills investment plan, and our place in time. So we've got some really big strategic drivers in Scotland to drive this work forward. But it takes skills and expertise to navigate those conversations, both within the sector and with those non-heritage stakeholders. And CIfA is able to do that because we have been working in this space for some time now. I'll be honest, some of those stakeholders have very traditional ideas about who archaeologists are and the work it is that we do. Indiana Jones has a lot to answer for. It's taking time, it takes time and resource to realign those viewpoints and to demonstrate through numerous business cases, data-led reviews, that we are a sector ready to deliver apprenticeships. And of course we're ready, because we're doing it in England. We as a sector are delivering apprenticeships, heritage apprenticeships in England. Developed by the Historic Environment Trailblazer Group, these heritage apprenticeships have been designed by leading employers to ensure that they deliver the professional skills employers need. And there are currently 6 apprenticeship standards available for delivery. In April 2022, CIfA was approved by Ofqual, that's the Office for Qualifications and Examinations Regulation, to be an endpoint assessment organisation for the Heritage Apprenticeship Standards. It's probably fair to say that that was a big step change for us as an organisation to take on that role, to take on that process. But if we hadn't, we're not sure who else would have within the sector. And without that role, it's difficult to work out how, as a sector, we can deliver apprenticeships. That element of CIfA's work is led by our colleague Amanda Wood, and when I asked her for some key facts for this talk, she sent on that we've successfully delivered endpoint assessments for the first cohort of Level 4 Historic Environment Advice Assistant apprenticeships. We're now assessing a cohort of Level 3 Archaeology Technician apprenticeships. We're gearing up to assess the Level 7 Archaeology Specialist apprenticeship in due course, and we're expecting another cohort of the Level 4 Historic Environment Advice Assistant Apprenticeships to start in the autumn of 2023. So we're getting the numbers through, we're getting progress through, we're getting candidates to come through onto these schemes and these initiatives. And the feedback from the apprentices themselves is that the experience has been really, really positive for them. A lot of the English apprenticeship standards are up for revision at the moment, and we're working on revisions for the Level 3 apprenticeship technician alongside key stakeholders, some of whom will be here during the conference. But while apprenticeships are only one way of supporting different entry routes into careers in archaeology, we've also been supporting the sector to deliver training schemes through our CIfA-approved employer training scheme initiative and through our work with the MVQ Level 3 in archaeological practice, a qualification that was developed in response to the need from the sector for accredited vocational awards. And as we've heard this morning, we've been heavily involved with the accredited degree programme that works led by my colleague Anna Welsh. And that's helping to increase knowledge about careers and professional pathways to the next generation of archaeologists. I work, do a lot of university work up in Scotland, and I love working with the students and learning about what they learn and how we can start to embed those ideas about what a career in archaeology can look like. But to create sustainable careers in archaeology, we need to support equitable access to training and career development opportunities. We know that not everyone can access those vital formal training opportunities, and that CIfA has a role to play to enable accessible opportunities to training. An example of this is our work again in Scotland, and through dedicated funding from Historic Environment Scotland, CIfA has been able to deliver a series of CPD workshops aimed at upskilling archaeologists based and working within Scotland since 2015. Building upon previous CPD workshops delivered by the CIfA Scottish Group, these CPD opportunities are designed to create awareness of a subject matter. These workshops are designed to be high-level introductions that can lead to general understandings of a subject or encourage the attendee to go further and learn more. And the topics have been really wide and really varied. They've been covered things like first aid for mental health, introduction to photogrammetry and RTI, volunteer management, the practical application of dendrochronology, neurodiversity awareness training. If you name it, if anyone's got a suggestion for a CPD workshop, we stick it on the spreadsheet and work out how we can deliver it. And thanks to that funding from HES, from Historic Environment Scotland, CIfA is able to pay for expert trainers, travel and attendance bursaries and refreshments throughout the day. Since 2020, the CPD provision has moved online, but this has enabled a wider geographical reach for the workshops. And we've started seeing attendees from Shetland down to Dumfries and Galloway. So it's been really great to see that in more inclusive access to the workshops go forward. And since 2015, we've had 452 practitioners attend a workshop on that CPD programme. So all of this work, and it's completed by my colleagues, Amanda, Anna, Jen, Kate and myself, it all contributes to that aim of creating sustainable and equitable career paths for all archaeologists now and the future. It's been a challenging few years for the sector and for the world, and we know that there's a lot of challenges ahead in the immediate future. We can acknowledge that our work has changed. We've adapted to different work cultures, and there's an opportunity to see how this different working culture, i.e. working, offering more flexible working, more online engagement, how we can start to take that changing working culture and apply it to how we deliver training and access to professional development opportunities. I really hope as a sector, we can continue to address skill gaps and training delivery with innovative approaches. And I look forward to see how we tackle that in the next few years. Going forwards, we need to increase the capacity with training schemes and apprenticeships, look for every opportunity possible to deliver those schemes in the work that we do. We should try and utilise the strategic work currently taking place. Our work is heavily linked to Scotland's archaeology strategy up in Scotland, and that's enabled us to apply for dedicated funding to support that skill development work in Scotland. And we really want to work more as much as possible with employers and support them to engage with these initiatives. And how can subsector partnerships really help there? So I'm going to end on a personal reflection. When I first started formally working in this space, that's professional development, I had no idea how long it would take to get these initiatives over the line. I also didn't consider how long it might be that we might see a positive impact of this work. But I've come to understand that as an archaeologist who's probably around mid-career now, I might not see the impact of my work that I'm doing for another 10 or 20 years. But that doesn't mean that we shouldn't be doing it. We're dismantling long-held notions on the best ways to create archaeologists. That doesn't mean we take and throw out all the existing methods that we use, but there are plenty of opportunities to look at how we can enhance our current methods. I know that there are some fantastic people working in this space, and that change is already discernible in some places. We just need to keep that momentum of progress going. Thank you.